combination of topics. And in this presentation, there will be an attempt to bridge some gaps. The first one is understanding and using load pool really properly. Also using in combination with the load pool, the load lines presentation on IV curves, so they can help understand better how we design. And maybe bridge a gap between scientific academic results with practical design tools and methods. Maybe we go to a few very basic things, but sometimes I've been astonished when someone with PhD, you try to explain how to design an amplifier, and they go and design it, and the result is 15 watts, when it was supposed to be 50 watts. And I'm asking how was the output of the transistor designed, and they tell me for flat gain. And I astonishingly ask why flat gain, and they tell me linearity. So there are sometimes these basic gaps which I want to address. And so load pool power contours measured and simulated. And everything starts with Steve Cripps, and very often I present Steve Cripps in front of Steve Cripps, it happens. So he said the shapes looks like eggs and rugby balls, not oranges and soccer balls. I guess being British, he was trying to tease the American cousins across the Atlantic with these comparisons. But these shapes, as a difference with the linear expressions for a transistor, are not any more circles of gain or noise figure. They're obviously, yes, egg shapes. And the original assumption was, well, it's non-linearities. Question is, what non-linearity? And Steve Cripps explained it to us. He first noticed that the shapes are there, doesn't matter, the same, doesn't matter what the compression point is. So very ingeniously, he put the mathematics together and explained to us that these rugby ball shapes are intersection of constant resistance, contrast conductance circles at the reference plane of the intrinsic generator. And this is because the load lines clip at the rail of the voltage or the current. There is way more said here. You have to go read, if you haven't, I doubt that you haven't, his publications, his first paper and the technical note, and I continue here, and here what it shows is this really following at the intrinsic generator, the constant resistance and constant conductance portions of the circle, and you can see that that one is this point R low compared with the R optimum. It's the straight line, and then when you start putting reactants, it follows this curve, when the other one is following this curve. And so you can plot with his equations that, and it comes on top of measurements. Yeah. 1982, yes. So I'm saying it here, actually. Well, 83, but he says 82, fine. Yeah. So at that time, only load pool kind of was available, no non-linear simulations, and it was the only way to do it, with Steve Cripps faster than the load pool and way cheaper. So then we had already the simulations, but they were still very slow and not readily available to the real engineers in the industry. So it was still offering a very effective way of designing this approach. So there was this expressed wish that the general simulators adopt the method in the same way as to compute noise figure. And also notice that maybe slightly more innovative approach will widened the application where feedback, multi-stage could be done with that approach. And I don't think it ever happened usefully in a general simulator. Yeah. So even today, when we have the simulated load pool tools, I think the method is applicable and very fast and cheap to design. At the beginning, it was mostly class A address, but actually, it's fully applicable to class B, or deep class AB, and class F, and inverted class F, I would say. So the only tool that uses really CRIPS approach fully and usefully is this tool called Amplify Design Wizard. Peter Abre invented some power parameters. So in this case, the full linear model is used. Properly established IV curves, you can copy them actually from the nonlinear model simulations. And in this way, the load lines instantaneously plotted at any reference plane outside of the transistor. And it includes feedbacks, resistive loading, change of the grounding node, parallel chips together, reference plane issues, multi-stage, etc. Everything works there. And you can see across frequencies plotted the curves. This is across quite a big frequency band, and it's instantaneous nearly to achieve it once you have the linear model, which is not very difficult to extract from whatever S parameters, and the proper IV curves. So let's compare what happens between load pool simulated results and let's call it extended CRIPS method. And the transistor is a 25 watt, not the 10 watt. So first, let's look at how to set up and organize properly load pool. Before everything, it's good to unconditionally stabilize the transistor. We add in here voltage and current source meters. This is needed to do the load pool proper script of Microwave Office. So what we do here really to achieve class B load pool contours for power and efficiency, we preset up this tuner. The second and the third harmonics, as you can see, are short. The fundamental is the optimum load line. It's tuned. And this is at the intrinsic generator, right? One must be careful with the harmonics. If they are not pre-tuned here, it's not going to be the proper result. But even the fourth and the fifth have to be taken in account if you're going to simulate with fourth and fifth. But turns out that only with, if you force the harmonic simulator to work only with three harmonics, it's good enough. It gives the same result as if you use more of them. The input then is tuned for high gain at probably high power. And the power is also swept because I think that load pool contours for power and efficiency are only proper if they're combined with constant gain compression. Otherwise, they become a mix between power and gain circles, which is not quite correct. So it's maybe useful to look from this schematic when you tune what's happening on the IV curves with the load lines. So you see the complex one here. This is the fundamental. It's exactly this R optimum. And they are the second and the third. They're vertical because they're short tit at the intrinsic generator. They're not quite vertical because there's a bit of feedback, so a bit tilted. But there is a class F mode where the third harmonic is fully flat. So this is kind of a visual way to see that you're really working towards the proper setup. Okay, comparison. Simulated with what I just showed you, the way load pool contours from nonlinear model. This is the CRIPS approach in the software, and they're on top of each other. Let's go further. What about class F and inverted class F? This graph shows load pool power contours, constant power contours for class B, the blue, class F, inverted class F, and the optimum, the maximum power points, which are also plotted here at the intrinsic generator. And the numbers we get is what's published in the industry, what they should be, very close. So it's the calculations from theory and the real load pool really comply. They come together. But there is what the amplifier design wizard can plot for you instantaneously without doing the enormous load pool simulations. Okay, efficiency contours. So class B, we have the blue power constant contours, and the other one, the constant efficiency contours. Over here, we plot the efficiency contours for class B, F, and inverted F, and here the power and the efficiency contours of, again, the free modes, the ideal ones. Now, Steve Cripps just reported that they did this for, so the same way the instantaneous plotting of the power contours, now it's possible to do by his publication the efficiency, but it's still not adopted anywhere, including this amplifier design wizard. But there is a way to use only the power contours and still design for high efficiency, and I'll show you how I think it could be done. Before that, let's look again so I understand even a bit better maybe what happens with these load pool contours. What I want to point attention here is, see how they follow each other here? So on each power contour across this, the efficiency is also constant. And on each efficiency constant, the power is also constant, which is obviously not the same here. Let's see what's what. Back to the Steve Cripps graphs. So over here, at R low, this is the R optimum is this line, we're clipping at the high current. And when we put the reactances, the maximum current is still the same, which means the DC current is the same physically, which means the efficiency is the same. So we are on the power contour, but the efficiency also the same, constant, I mean. It's a constant power and constant efficiency simultaneously. When we start clipping on the voltage at the knee, well, current changes. So efficiency changes. So over here, we have the maximum efficiency on the constant power contour at R high, but otherwise it's less anyway else. There was something else there that I probably wanted to say. Right. So if you're at R optimum and start moving on the central line this direction, this is where all the maximum points are, maximum power, maximum efficiency, and the efficiency kind of increases in this direction for each mode until we start coming down, and from mode to mode. Class F is higher than class B, if inverted F is even higher, and so on. So, if we look at this graph here, where we have contours for power and efficiency from class B to class F to inverted class F, and we connect all the optimum points, it forms a curve. And that curve actually on the previous graph stays, is not a curve, it's a straight line, as we already showed on the axis of the horizontal axis of the Smith chart. And it's the same graph you do class B, for example. And now where the power and the efficiency contours touch each other, you can draw this line. And it's the same as here, as the other graph. So let's do it by the
hey.
Right. Let's take the reserve saber, lightsaber. even this one. What's going on? Some magic here that they don't want to work? Okay, so at the intrinsic generator, when the transistor parasitics are stripped, this is where the constant power contours are. We can draw this line, and by the Peter-Abris power parameters, once the parasitics are, and this is at the output, put, and so we have the curve. Now, that curve, we're going to call it maximum efficiency line. This was introduced last year at the same forum, but now I'm repeating it with a bit more basic explanations. Maybe it's interesting to look at why they're curved. If the Smith chart is normalized at R optimum, they're symmetrical on both sides. When it's lower, it's the voltage clipping that has become more curved. It's the other way around when the R optimum is higher than 50 ohm, for example. And what happens here is when you add the parasitics, this one comes here, but that one comes there. It's not very nice to work in this area, actually. And at high frequency, very often happens because the lines are closed, the sensitivities are bigger. And this is high impedance. And working, and then it becomes very low outside. And providing at such high Q, playing around with open short on the harmonics, they kind of naturally want to be in class B here. Why am I showing this? On the simulated, let's say this is class B, you can figure out which side is the voltage or current clipping only where you see that the power contours and the efficiency contours don't follow each other. On this, if they were, you know, just to get the orientation, what's going on. So in AW, actually, it could be not just a line plotted, but it could be an area that you want to allow the impedances to exist. And there is a small circle here. When you ask the synthesizer to produce matching networks, instead of a point chosen, you can go for a circle, these kind of things. So when this area opens, we will start looking at the continuous modes, basically, in a way. But much larger deviation could be used with continuous modes, which in this case is not the topic, but just mentioning it. So in ADW, it's instantaneous plot of these curves for whatever frequency band you want. And you have in table whichever frequency you want, instantaneous results behind this. Here you plot only four of them across the bandwidth for, you know, for visual interpretation, but behind the humongous tables, you can achieve any frequency there. You can automatically select any point on this high efficiency line by saying, I want to compromise half a dB power or 1 dB power and quickly figure out what this brings to you. And you're going to our efficiency. Now, at this point, I want to point something that might be happening as a mistake often doing load pull. See, this is a transistor load pull for a data sheet. And at the output, the tuner for the second and third harmonic is at 50 ohm. And if we have to compare the real class B with shorted harmonics and the ones with 50 ohm, these are the constant power contours. They see a difference. It's much bigger on the efficiency contours. And strangely enough, with 50 ohm on the output, you get better results. So how do you design? How do you put the harmonics properly? Anyway, engineers must be very careful working with load pull data, which is given to them, instead of nonlinear models, linear models. The load pull data very often could be kind of misleading. Okay, so here I continue the same topic. This is what we see in the intrinsic generator when the harmonics are shorted, and this is where it's 50 ohm. And this is what's happening with the load lines. See the two second and third harmonic? They are neither short, neither open, neither in the middle of nowhere. So how do you design? ADW has this extensive preset up, and you can do a whole lot of choices. Class B, continuous class B, all the continuous modes, class BJ, whatever you choose. And you can play around with the requirements for the harmonic loading. And this is one example what you preset it up. There's the fundamental second harmonic, third harmonic. How do you achieve them is another story. But here there are two designs. The one that is faded was done in quite a few years ago, an attempt to use harmonics to define proper results or good results. We had a nonlinear transistor, but it didn't allow access to the intrinsic voltage and current at the intrinsic generator. So now you start doing these multiple iterations at each frequency of fundamental, second harmonic, third harmonic, and again until you get to something that you believe is optimum, but you can just believe it, you cannot prove it is. Once you have the intrinsic generator access, then you can see actually what's happening. So in the amplifier design wizard, on the maximum efficiency line, a few points were selected. And it gives you a bit simpler approach if you want. It's not here, but when you set up the harmonics, you can say, I want second harmonic to be low and third harmonic to be high. That's all you have to say to the synthesizer. And it's trying something, or you go around. And the result was a bit wider bandwidth, otherwise the same performance. This was also actually produced and tested, but the results are not here. But it has been proven time and time again that it works. So, how is this? This was what was synthesized in the ADW. Then it was transferred to microwave office. This was also synthesized in the ADW. We used the nonlinear model here, the EM simulator, to fully and properly simulate the lump components, all from modelitics, very well defined. It's probably interesting to look also at, this thing doesn't work anymore, at the waveforms, and you can see the fundamental, the second and the third, and probably it's interesting to imagine from them how the whole shape comes together, gives you more information. That's it, info. It's also interesting, I'm going back, class B, class F, look how they look, just to remind you what it was. And let's look now what happens. So in the middle of the band, this is what we have for the fundamental, and you can see the second and the third harmonic. The second is flattening down, the third is going like in a circle. You can see where they're on the Smith chart, they're slightly negative, by the way. And the thing is that it looks like inverted class F, but the third harmonic is neither short, neither open, although it's very close to short. The thing is to understand the ratio here. So the second harmonic impedance, reactive impedance, is higher than the fundamental impedance. And that's why it's already flattening. It doesn't need to be, instead of here, to be there on the high impedances. It's a matter of ratio with the fundamental, not what's happening exactly on the Smith chart. So not to be confused with these things. So I don't know what class this complies with. Can someone explain to me? So the first sentence here is probably a bit too strong, but my experience with playing around with continuous modes is that very difficult to achieve the coherence there between the fundamental reactance and amplitude value and the second harmonic reactance and the third harmonic to be close to short to open, kind of never happens. Of course, the math is still usable, very elegant, but it's just the first setup. What actually happens afterwards is another story. So that's why I have chosen the maximum efficiency line. I prefer to ask the synthesis tool to stay on the purely resistive fundamental and then vary the, if possible, play with the harmonic reactant and see what happens. And whatever results you achieve, they've never been worse than trying to play with continuous modes. In moderate bandwidth, 30%, 40%, this kind of thing. But that falls together with another approach. Here we have fundamental already chosen, and then second and third harmonics swept across the edges of the Smith chart, and then a 3dB plot of what's happening. And these are the slices where you want the power and the efficiency, and now we can choose probably to be here. And what we... Another usefulness of this kind of simulation, nonlinear simulation, is that it shows you where it shouldn't be. You can see these deep valleys that destroy the performance. And you should stay away from them. And specifically for this transistor, the maximum is very close to the minimum. So one should be careful to put it at the maximum, actually. You might get in trouble with temperature and tolerances and things like that. Microwave office can do it. This is one way of doing it. The slice is not here, but you can bring the bottom up and leave what you only want at power level and efficiency and choose your range of allowable second and third harmonic reactants to set up the synthesizer to do it. It's still work in progress. A much more versatile, sophisticated tool is coming. I hope to be nice one day. Useful. That's about it. Don't even know what to conclude exactly. Hopefully it was useful.